So hello students, welcome to the second part of VHDL programming concept. So in this class we are going to discuss how to write a VHDL module for the combinational circuit and how to write VHDL code for multiplexers. So students, in my previous video lecture we have discussed how to write the basic syntax of VHDL statements, like your assignment operators, okay, and your concurrent statements, etc. Now let us see how to write a VHDL modules, or how to write a complete code for a particular digital system using your VHDL programming concepts. So students, to write a complete VHDL module, we must declare all of the input and output signals using an entity declaration, and then specify the internal operations of the module using an architecture declaration. So you can see the VHDL program structure as shown here below. Okay, that is, the system in VHDL contains the entity. You have the entity, okay, and then you have an architecture, entity and architecture, okay, at the top level. And we have to specify an entity and architecture for each of the component modules that are part of the system. So important thing is you have to declare first the entity, and second one is your architecture for that particular system. And then, so whatever components that build up the system, for that each component you have to define the entity and architecture. Okay, so suppose you have a module, you have two modules, then you have, for module 1 you have to declare the entity and the architecture, for module 2 you have to declare the entity and architecture, and so on. Okay, so for each one we have to specify an entity and architecture for each component module that is part of your system. So we can see here the entity and architecture at the top level, entity and architecture at the top level, and sub entity and architecture, the sub entity and architecture for each module of the system. Fine. Now after understanding this, we now move on to the syntax declaration, okay, of an entity. Okay, so now let us see the syntax of an entity declaration. So entity declaration, it defines the name, input output signals and modes of the hardware module. Okay, so the syntax for the entity module is, we have the keyword entity followed by the entity name, and then one more, we have the keyword, that is. One more, you have the keyword is. So is another keyword that you could find. So this one, is another keyword, then entity is another keyword. And then we have in square brackets the port, and with the opening bracket we have the interface signal declaration. We close the bracket followed by the semicolon and then the square bracket. Then we have the end to that particular entity followed by entity, or in bracket we have the entity name. Okay, so this is how we write the entity for a particular component. Okay, so anything that you specify within the square bracket, anything that you specify within the square bracket, as I have told you in my previous class, is optional. Okay, so the whatever you specify in the square bracket indicate the optional. So an entity declaration defines the name, input and output, or in out, okay, signals and most of the hardware modules. Okay, so each entity declaration includes a list of interface. So each entity includes a list of interfaces, okay, signals that can be used to connect to other modules of the outside world. So this is how the syntax of your entity looks like. Entity is the keyword followed by the entity name, and then followed by the another keyword is, and in square bracket we have the port. Okay, we have different ports that we'll be discussing. In that we have the interface signal declaration, and then we end the entity with the keyword end followed by the entity or the entity name, and whatever parameters that you pass through these square brackets are optional. Okay, this is all about your entity declaration. The next one is the syntax for your interface declaration, interface signal declaration. So as we know that each entity declaration includes a list of interface signals that can be used to connect to the other modules or to the outside world. Okay, so the syntax for your interface signal are, you have the list of interface signals followed by the colon and then mode type in the square bracket followed by colon equal to initial values, and we complete the bracket. And then in the curly braces followed by a semicolon, we have the list of interface signals followed by a colon, mode type, and in square bracket followed by colon equal to the initial values, and we complete the square bracket, the curly braces, and the semicolon. So students, this curly brackets what we have indicate zero or more occurrence repetitions of your enclosed class. What does curly braces indicate? The curly braces indicate zero or more repetitions of the enclosed class. Okay, so we have different mode types. Okay, they are the input mode, the output mode, and the bidirectional mode. So the input signal are of mode in for input, then we have out. Output signals are using the output mode out, and the bidirectional signals are using the mode in out. Okay, so we have in out as a bidirectional signal mode, we have the out for the output signal mode, and in for the input signal mode. These are the type of mode which can be used in the interface signal declaration. Okay, again, anything that we have written inside the square bracket are optional. So this is how we write the syntax for your interface signal declaration. So we'll understand this in a better way once we take few of the examples. Okay, now, so with each entity, okay, there can be one or more architecture. So with each entity there can be one or more architecture associated. Okay, now let us see the syntax of writing the architecture. So architecture can be described using structural, data flow, behavioral, or mixed style. Okay, fine. So the syntax of the architecture is, we have the keyword architecture followed by the architecture name, which is user defined. Okay, then there is another keyword called as of, and then we have the entity name. So whenever you are declaring an entity, there you must have given the entity name. That entity name you have to declare here, for which we are going to write the architecture and the code that will perform the necessary operation, followed by the another keyword is, then you have the declaration part. Then we have the body of the architecture, which starts with begin. Then we write the set of concurrent statements within the architecture body, and finally we end up with the keyword end followed by the architecture or architecture name specified in the square brackets, which again are optional. Okay, but it's necessary to write the architecture name, because okay, if there are more than one architecture written, then there will be ambiguity created for which module this architecture is been designed. So basically you have to specify. Okay, so as I told you, even though writing architecture name is optional, but we write the architecture name associated when we have more than one architecture written right for the particular module in order to avoid ambiguity. So in the declaration section of the architecture, we can declare signals and components. We can declare signals and components that are used within this architecture. The architecture body contains the statements that describe the operation of that particular module. Fine. So now, student, let us understand how to write a VHDL code for NOT gate. Okay, so as we have seen the syntax for your entity, we have syntax for your module, and then we have we have the syntax for your interface, entity, interface, and then we have the syntax for your architecture. Now we'll see how these three parameters can be used in writing the basic program, VHDL program. So let us start by taking the basic examples of your basic gates. So we'll write a small VHDL code using all these three modules using your basic gates. So as you know, the three basic gates are your NOT gate, OR gate, and your AND gate. So what is a NOT gate? A NOT gate with only one input and produces the complement output. So here we have a symbol of a NOT gate where A acts as an input and whatever input that you give, and F acts as an output. So the logic symbol of NOT gate is as shown. Then we have the truth table where if you see where if I give you a 0, it produces the complement of that, it produces 1. If I give you a 1, it produces the output 0. And the logical expression what we have is F is equal to A bar, or we call it as F complement. F is equal to A complement. Okay, and then similarly you have the OR gate which perform addition operation. So you know the output of the OR gate is high only when both or either of the input is high, and output is low when both the inputs are low. So this is the logic symbol of the OR gate. So OR gate has two inputs A and B and produces the sum of the two inputs, that is C is equal to A plus B. Okay, and then we have the AND gate which has again the two inputs. It performs the multiplication operation. So here the output of AND gate is high only when both the inputs are high. Okay, and the output is low when both or either of the input is low. The logical expression is C is equal to A into B. Okay, so let us write the VHDL code for the NOT gate. First we'll write the entity. So what is an entity? Entity keyword followed by the name of the entity. The name of the entity is user defined. So I have given the name it as NOT G. Is another keyword, and port. Now port specifies the input, output, and the bidirectional. So for NOT gate, as I told you, here we draw the logic symbol of this. So here it is. So what is that? We have A, okay, and F. So what is F? F is equal to nothing but A bar. Okay, so A acts as an input. So I have written it as A. And the data type for this input is bit. So as we receive the data either in a form of 0 and 1. So the value of A can be 0 or the value of A can be 1. So either of one. So we have a data type called as bit. So in is the port mode in which we call it as a input mode. Okay, so A acts as an input mode. Then followed by semicolon, and then F colon equal to out. Out indicates what? It is an output bit. It is an output bit. So it will produce the complement of it. So we are going to specify what is A and what is F. So A is input, F is output. That is what we have. And the data type for these two input parameters and output parameters are bit. Okay, and then we end that particular entity with the entity name again, which is an optional parameter, but still we have a practice of giving the name to that particular entity, which is NOT G. Now let us declare the architecture part of it. So how do we declare the architecture? Where the actual code is going to be written. So architecture, the name of the architecture, we have written it as not ARCH of the interface not gate NOTG. So I have specified NOTG as the name to the entity. So is and begin. In the begin part, we have the body of that particular architecture written. So what is that? We have the assignment statement written. So F less than equal to not of A. So what is that? F is equal less than or equal to not of A. So we have F is equal to A bar. So F is equal to A bar, that is not of A. And then we end this particular architecture with the not architecture name given as not ARCH. Okay, this is how the VHDL code using your entity and architecture is written for the not gate. So this example we have taken, basic example we have taken, so that you can understand the way we write the VHDL code for a given circuitry. Fine. Now let us see how to write the architecture code with respect to your AND gate. Okay, so we have seen all the necessary things, okay, for NOT gate. Similarly, we'll be writing the VHDL code for the AND gate. So first write the entity. How do we write? We start with the keyword entity followed by the entity name. I have given it as AND gate, ANDG, followed by the keyword is. And then, as we know, AND gate has two inputs, A and B, and it performs the multiplication operation. So I write the input as A and B. So input port, we have A and B, and the data type is bit, because we are going to receive either 00, 01, 10, and 11. So these are the bits. And what is the output? C is the output. C is the output, which is going to produce either result as 0 or it is going to produce the result as 1 based on the input values that are being supplied to this input bit. Okay, and then I end the entity. Then I write the architecture part. In the architecture part, I first write the architecture, which is a keyword. Then I specify the architecture name, followed by the keyword of, then the name of the entity, that is your AND G, followed by the keyword is, and then we have the body of that particular architecture, C less than or equal to A and B. Okay, so C is less than or equal to A and B. So output C is equal to A into B. This is what it is. This is the code which is written in your architecture body, which will perform exactly the same operation of your AND gate using a software. Okay, fine. After understanding the code written for NOT gate and AND gate, then it's time to write the VHDL code for your OR gate. So as we know, OR gate also has two inputs and one output. This logical symbol we have discussed. So as I told you, it has two inputs, A and B, and then we have one output C. Now C performs what? C is equal to A plus B. C is equal to A plus B. So again, A and B acts as an input, C acts as an output. The data type is bit for both input and output. We end the entity with the entity name, followed by next is your architecture name for a given entity, and then we are going to write the body of that particular architecture, C less than or equal to A or B. So this is how we have written the architecture code for the AND gate, OR gate, and the NOT gate. Now let us take a simple circuit and then build up the VHDL code for the given consent architecture system or the circuit. So we have this particular circuit. Okay, so you can see here we have two gates. The first gate is your AND gate and the second gate is your OR gate. So AND gate has two inputs A and B and one output C. OR gate also has two inputs C and D and one output E. But you can see the one input of the OR gate is coming from the output of the AND gate. So the output of AND gate is connected as an input to the OR gate. So let us write the VHDL code for the given circuit. So we have the interface, we have the entity, and then we write the entity name. We give it as 2_gates. So as it is user defined, you can specify your own name to that particular entity, followed by the keyword is, and then we have the port. We have the port, and here you can see A B D are the input and E is the output. A, B, D are the inputs and E is the output. And then we end up with 2 gates. Okay, we end this entity by writing the entity name. And then we have the architecture, where we have specified the architecture name for the entity that we have specified. Then we have the signal C. We have the signal C. Okay, we have the signal C, which is of type wait. Okay, and then we write the main code for this particular system what we have designed. So C, first we have to write the code for this particular system. So C is less than or equal to A and B. So C is less than or equal to A and B, and we have the concurrent statements been written. We have the concurrent statements been written, and after execution of this statement, then we have E, then we have E less than or equal to, we have E less than or equal to C or D. So now we write the code for this pattern, E less than or equal to C or D. That is what we have written. So these are the concurrent statements that execute one after other as and when the input values of A, B and D changes. Okay, so this is how we write the entity code and the architecture code for the given particular circuit diagram. Okay, then let us take one more example for a better understanding, and we have a code for your full adder. So what is full adder? You know that a full adder is a circuitry which performs operation of your on your 3 bits. Okay, so here we have the entity architecture. Okay, so we have entity name as full adder. Okay, and the ports, input ports are X, Y and C. So we have 3 inputs, X, Y and C in. We have the 3 inputs, X, Y and C in, and the output are C out and sum. We have the output C out and sum. Okay, so here you can see we have a port X, Y, C in, which are acting as an input bit, which are the inputs, and then we have the C out and sum, which are acting as a output, which are acting as an output. Okay, then we have the ending part of this particular entity with the entity. Then the architecture that we write is architecture equations of full adder, which we have written. Then we have is begin, then the concurrent statements are being written inside the body of the particular architecture. So what is that? Sum less than or equal to X, X or Y, X or C in after 10 nanoseconds. So we have added a delay so that the circuit will perform the necessary operation and the result is available in the sum. After 10 nanoseconds, the next concurrent statement gets executed, which is written as C out. We have written the code for C in, sum. Now we are writing it for C out less than or equal to X and Y or X and C in or Y and C in after 10 nanoseconds equation. So we have this equation written for your full adder. Okay, so this is how the entity and architecture code is written for your full adder. Now in continuation with your full adder, now let us write a VHDL code for a full bit 4 adder. For a 4-bit full adder. Okay, so in case of a 4-bit full adder, we find 4 full adder as shown in the figure. So this is we are going to write a VHDL code for a 4-bit full adder. So in the figure you can see we have 4 full adders. Okay, this is the first full adder, the second full adder, the third full adder, and the fourth full adder. Okay, so for the first full adder, A0 and B0 are acting as an input along with another input CI, and we have two outputs for this first full adder. One is S0 and the second one is C1. For the second full adder, you can find A1, B1 acting as an input along with the third input C1, and the output are S1 and C2. For the third full adder, we have A2 and B2 acting as an input along with C2, and the output are S2 and C3. The fourth full adder contains the input A3 and B3, and along with the another input, the third input is your C3, which is coming from the output of the third full adder, and then we have the output S3 and C0 or C out. So these are the basic structure of your 4-bit full adder. Okay, now let us write the VHDL code for this 4-bit full adder. Okay, so we have the entity written first. Entity, the name of the entity is adder4, followed by the keyword is. Then we have the port. The port names are A and B. Here A and B are the name given to the input ports, and we have the bit vector. Okay, what is this bit vector? It is an array. It is an array. So here you can see 00, 1, 1, 2, 2, and 3, 3. So it is from 0 to 3. So array size is from 0 to 3. Okay, 0 to 3. Fine. So here we have written 3 down to 3. So in VHDL, array is known as your bit vector. So it is going to store each value for A of 0, A of 1, A of 2, and A of 3, B of 0, B of 1, B of 2, and B of 3, which is acting as an input port, along with CI acting as an input. Okay, so there are three inputs A, B, and C of I. Now S is another output port. Again, we declare it as a bit vector. It is 3 down to 0. Here we have S0, S1, S2, and S3. So we have an array. We have an array of which is declared as a S of 3. We have S of 3. Why S of 3? Because S0, S1, S2, and S3. Okay, so 0, 1, 2, 3. So what is that is what it is going to store. So 0 to 3 down to 0. This is how we write. And C0 is the output bit. Okay, C0 is the output. So A, B, and CI are the input ports, and S and C0 are the output port. And this is how we end our entity. Then the architecture for your 4-bit full adder is as shown. We have the architecture. followed by the name of the architecture, structure of adder 4. Okay, he is a component of your full adder. Okay, is a component of your full adder. So the ports are X, Y, and C in. X, Y, and C in are the input port. C out is the output port. C out and sum are your output port. Okay, so we are ending with the component, and then we have the signal C, which is a bit vector, okay, which is a bit vector, which is moving from 1 to 3. Okay, so here, which is moving from 1 to 3. So C in, that is a carry generated after each full adder, is acting as an input to the next full adder. So we write it as a signal. Okay, and then we write the body of the architecture, which we have instantiated with four copies of the full adder. So for the first full adder, A0. So for the first full adder, FA0, we give it as FA0, first full adder. Okay, so the code written is full adder port map A0, B0. Here we have A0 and B0. CI is another input, and then C1 and C1 and S0 is the output. C1 and S0 is another output for FA0. Okay, so this is the first code that we have written, instruction line that we have written, which perform the full adder operation for the given circuitry. So we are working on a 4-bit full adder, so we have this 4 full adders into picture. So we have written the code for the first full adder. Similarly, we have the code for the second full adder, FA1. So this is FA0, this is FA0, now this is FA1, this is FA1. Okay, now for FA1, A1 and B1 are the inputs, C1 is another input, and S1 and C2 are the output. So here we have full adder which will map the port A1, B1 and C1 are the inputs, and C2 and S1 are the output port. Similarly, for full adder 2, we have A2, B2 and C2 acting as an input, whereas C3 and S2 are acting as a output. And for the final full adder, that is full adder 3, we have the port map for A3, B3 and C3 as the input, and C0 and S3 acting as an output. So this is how the end of the structure of an architecture for a 4-bit full adder is written. Okay, so this is how you write the VHDL code for the 4-bit full adder for the circuit shown in the figure. Okay, now the next VHDL code what we are going to write is the VHDL model for a multiplexer. So previously we have studied what is signal. Okay, signal assignment operator. We have studied what is signal assignment operator, that is less than or equal to, using less than or equal to. And also what is conditional signal assignment. Okay, first we'll study the syntax of your conditional signal assignment statement. Okay, so the syntax for general form of a conditional signal assignment statement is, we have the signal name, followed by the less than or equal to operator, and then we have the expression when, expression 1, then the keyword when, followed by the condition 1, okay. So this is the syntax or the general form of a conditional signal assignment statement. So let us understand, and then followed by the else part, if condition 1 is false, we have the else part where expression 2 gets evaluated when condition 2 is true. Suppose if condition 1 is false and condition 2 is false, then we have another else part where expression n gets evaluated. Okay, so this is how your conditional signal assignment statement works. Signal name less than or equal to expression 1 followed by the keyword when, and then whatever condition they are writing. If that condition 1 is true, then the expression 1 gets evaluated. If else part comes into picture only when condition 1 is false, condition 2 gets evaluated and then the expression 2 gets executed. Okay, and if 1 and 2 are not executing, then we have the else part where expression n gets evaluated. So let us take an example. Let us take an example of a 2 is to 1 multiplexer. So 2 is to 1 multiplexer, students, as you know, we have 2 inputs and 1 output. Okay, and 1 select line. Okay, so A is acting as a select line. I naught is one input and I1 is another output. So if A is equal to 0, you know the whatever input that is available on the input line is made available on the output line. So when A is equal to 0, F is equal to I naught. So when A is equal to 1, you know the input available on the input line I1 will be made available on the output line. So at that time F will be equal to I1. Okay, so the code that we write is F less than or equal to I0 when A equal to 0, F is less than or equal to I0 when A equal to 0, else I1. So here the condition is, if A is equal to 0, then the expression F I0 will be executed and the value is assigned to F1. Else we go to the next condition. As we have only two conditions, this is how we write the signal condition assignment statement. We have taken example of a 2 is to 1 multiplexer for your better understanding. Okay, fine. Now, consider a cascaded 2 is to 1 multiplexer. Cascaded 2 is to 1 multiplexer in the sense what? We have two multiplexer of 2 is to 1 connected to each other. That's what we name called as cascaded 2 is to 1 multiplexer. So here the signal code that we have written is F less than or equal to A, F which is an output. Okay, F which is an output is equal to A when E is equal to 1. When E is equal to 1, whatever input that is available on the input line A is made available on the output line F. Else B when D is equal to 1. So when D is equal to 1, whatever input that is available on the input line B is made available on the output line of F. And when D is equal to 1, okay, else C. So if D is equal to 0, whatever input that is available on the input line C is made available on the output line F. So when E is equal to 1, F value is set to A. When E is equal to 1, I will explain it once again. So when E equal to 1, F is equal to A. So whatever input that is available on the input line of A is made available on the output line. Okay. When E equal to 0, okay, F value depends on D. F value completely depends on D. Okay, so when D is equal to 1, then F value is set to B. So the FB is now set to A. Okay, F. And when D is equal to 0, when D is equal to 0, F value is set to C. F value is set to C. Okay, so this is how we write the conditional code statements for the cascaded 2:1 multiplexer. Okay, now moving on, let us take another example for understanding the VHDL code module for multiplexers. So earlier we have seen VHDL code for basic gates and your full adders, okay, or your adder circuit. Then we have the VHDL module for your multiplexer. So we have the code for the 4:1 multiplexer. The logic equation is F is equal to A bar B bar I naught plus A bar B bar I1 and A bar B I1. The second one is A B bar I2 and A B I3. So the code that we are going to write here is F less than or equal to not of A, not of A because we have written it as A bar, and A bar into B it is, so B bar it is, so not of B and I not, or we have not of A and B and I1, or A and not of B. I am writing this code for this particular equation, A and not of B and I2, or we have A and B and I3, A and B and I3. So these are the code that we have written for your multiplexer. We have written the code for your multiplexer. Okay. Understood. So this is how we write the VHDL modules for your multiplexer. Okay, so the next part that you need to understand is, what do you mean by selected signal assignment? What do you mean by selected signal assignment statement? So select statement are used to assign signals in VHDL. Select statements are used to assign signals in VHDL. They can only be used in combinational code. They can only be used in combinational code outside of a process. Selected signal assignments is a clear way of assigning a signal based on a specific list of combinational for one input signal. Okay, so what is a selected signal assignment statement? A selected signal assignment statement, okay, statement are used to assign signal in VHDL. They can only be used in combinational code outside of a process. Selected. So the selected signal assignment is a clear way of assigning a signal based on a specific list of combination for one input signal. So the general form of select assignment statement is, okay, with the expression, with is a keyword, expression underscore s is the name of the selected signal assignment statement given. Then we have the keyword select, this is again a user defined. We have the keyword select, and then we have the signal with the assignment statement less than or equal to expression 1, in bracket we have the keyword after, we mention the delay time, close the bracket, followed by the another keyword when, and then we have a choice 1, followed by expression 2, and then in square bracket we have the after keyword with the delay time, close the square bracket with the another statement when, which is a keyword, followed by choice 2, and so on up to expression n with a certain delay. And if these are not happening, then we have others to execute. Okay, it is the syntax for your selected signal assignment statement. Fine. Now we'll see how to use this selected signal assignment statement with a small VHDL code for 4:1 multiplexer. Okay, so you have the code using select assignment statement. Okay, we have SEL less than or equal to A and B. Okay, SEL less than or equal to A and B. So here this ampersand acts as a concatenation operator. This signal AND acts as a concatenation operator. Okay, so it will assign the concatenation value of A and B to your select signal. Okay, so the select signal assignment statement looks like this: SEL less than or equal to A and B, where ampersand acts as a concatenation operator, where it assigns the concatenated values of A and B to SEL. Okay, then we have a keyword with the name of the select statement SEL. Then we have the keyword select F less than or equal to I naught when 00, I1 when 01, I2 when 10, and I3 when 11. So here when it is 00, when the two select lines A and B are 00, F will be assigned a value I0. When it is 01, when the select lines A and B are 01, then I1 will be assigned to value F. When it is 10, I2 will be assigned the value to F. And when it is 11, then I3 will be assigned the value F. Okay, so we have the code written for the select statement. We have code written for the select statement. So when it is 00, I0 will be assigned to F. When it is 01, I1 will be assigned to F. When it is 10, I2 will be assigned to F. And when it is 11, I3 will be assigned to F. And this is how the select statement code is written. The only thing you need to understand is that whenever you are writing an ampersand symbol, the ampersand symbol here is used for concatenation of two values 00, 01, 10, and 1. Okay, fine. This is one. So next we have the 4:1 multiplexer code written using conditional assignment statement. So we have code using conditional assignment statement. So what is that conditional assignment statement? We have written F less than or equal to I0 when A and B equal to 00, else I1 when A and B equal to 01, else I2 when A and B equal to 10, else I3. Or using the conditional code assignment, this is written using your select assignment statement. Now with respect to your conditional assignment statement, how do I do? F is less than or equal to I0 when A equal to 0. F is less than or equal to I0 when A equal to 0. And now here you can see this AND performs just like a logical operation. This AND performs like a logical operation, that you remember. There is a difference between the ampersand and your AND. Here AND acts as a logical operator, whereas ampersand acts as a concatenation operator. So we have two statements, ampersand and your AND. This AND acts as an logical operator, whereas ampersand acts as a concatenation operator. Okay, so we have a code written F less than or equal to I0 when A equal to 0 and B equal to 0. So here we have the conditional assignment statements written. You can see here F less than or equal to I0 when A equal to 0 and, which is acting as a logical operator now, and B equal to 0, else I1 when A equal to 0 and B equal to 1, else I2 when A equal to 1 and B equal to 0, else I3. So this is how the code is written. So it is 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0 and 1, 1 written. So we have one code which is written using your conditional assignment statement and another code written using your select assignment statement that we have seen. Okay. Now, the next part, what you can see is the VHDL code for 8:1 multiplexer. Okay, so this is the last example that I will be taking in order to explain how to write a VHDL modules for multiplexer. Okay, so previously, whatever code we have written for multiplexer, we have not written the complete module for the multiplexer. We have written only the core of the multiplexer part, that is only the body of the architecture. We have not written the complete entity and architecture for the multiplexer. Now for 8:1 multiplexer, we'll write the complete module code for VHDL. We'll write the complete module code for VHDL. Okay, so first of all, let us understand the basic working of your 8:1 multiplexer. So this is the block diagram of 8:1 multiplexer. So here we have the select input lines S0, S1 and S2. So we have three select input lines, one output line, and then we have the input lines D0, D1, D2, D3, D4 and up to D7. So we have data input lines from D0 to D7, which are acting as a data input lines. And then we have three select lines, S0, S1 and S2, and the output line Y. So we have the truth table for the each combination of the select input lines, which of the data input line will be available on the output line Y. Okay, now let us write the VHDL module for this multiplexer. First, we write the entity for 8:1 multiplexer. We give the entity name MUX8:1. The port name, ports that we declare are S, the select input lines, which is acting as an input bit, which is 0 to 2, 0 to 2, okay, 0 to 2, okay, and D here, which is again acting as an input bit, which is an array of vectors from 0 to 7. So 0 to 7, this is what it is, from 0 to 7. Okay, D0 to D7. So we have, and Y is an output bit. So Y is an output bit. So this is the end of the entity with the entity name. So this is how we have written the entity for a VHDL module for multiplex. Next, we have VHDL module architecture for 8:1 multiplex. We start with begin with S as select. So here we have the select assignment statements written, Y less than or equal to D0 when it is 0, 0, 0. So here Y is equal to D0 when S0, S1 and S2 are 0, 0, 0. So that is what we have written here. D1 when S0, S1 and S2 are 0, 0, 1 and D1 when S0 is 1, S1 is 0 and S2 is 0, and then D2 when it is 010, D3 when 011, D4 when it is 100, D5 when 101 and D6 when it is 110 and D7 when others. When others in the sense what? D7 will be assigned to the output Y when it is S0 is 1, S1 is 1 and S2 is 1. So this is how the VHDL code for 8:1 multiplexer is written. Okay, So this is all about VHDL programming. So students, we have seen how we can write the same code using conditional assignment statement also. Okay, fine. Now, okay, so hope you have seen how to write the entire module structure for VHDL as well as how to write a VHDL code for a multiplexer. So this is all about your VHDL programming. So in exams, they may ask you to write a VHDL code for a multiplexer or a VHDL code for the basic gate that is been explained, or the VHDL code for a full adder or a 4-bit adder. So you have to write the code that we have explained in this particular video. So thank you, students. Thank you for attending and patiently listening to the concept of VHDL. Thank you.